Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode 206, I believe.
Yep, that's right. Yep.
Oh, how did... I don't understand how I even remembered that. It used to be that I couldn't even remember it, even if we recorded them back to back. Oh, man. Whew. We're doing it. Somehow. We're making it work, Gus. Veet, how have you been?
Been good, mate. I've been busy, but I'm sitting here wondering what the hell I've been doing, and I can't really put a finger on it. I guess there's work, and more work, sure. Bit of TV here. Haven't been seeing any movies. Finally catching up with a TV show that's come back after 13 years, but I'll talk about that at the end of this episode, because that's my episode next week. And I'm contemplating, maybe I could get your guys' opinion on this. There you go. This is some on-air advice. There's a position come up at work, and I'm not really sure if I should apply for it. It is a promotion, but I hear that somebody's been shoulder-tapped for that position. And people at work are sort of coming up to me and whispering, going, you should apply. You'd be good for it. You should apply. And I don't know if I want to go through all that effort. The shoulder tapping could be a rumor. It'd be a position that would suit me and my personality really well. But I don't know. And I've only just got this new job promotion, what now, 5-6 months now? So, I don't know if it's too soon, or how soon again this position will come up. So, I don't know. What do you guys reckon?
If it allows you to buy more tacos, you should do it.
See, that's the interesting thing about the work I do. Because I'm a shift worker, the benefit and pay comes from doing the shifts, the weekends, the nights, etc. Except they also have a drawback. Working all those shifts. This would be a Monday to Friday. I'm not going to say 9 to 5. I'm not kidding myself. It's sort of probably a 10-hour day, 7 to 4 type of day. But it is 5 days a week. But you're getting paid a salary as opposed to an hour. You're based on an hourly rate. So it's possible. My guess is I'll come out even, pay wise.
See, I'm one of those people, like, I very rarely get good opportunities, so I'm going to go with my biased opinion and say, right. Like, even though someone else may be rumored to go, like, oh, you should do that, you should look out for yourself. Like, if it's going to be better for you as a schedule, if it's something you like doing, I don't see why it would hurt. The worst that can happen is you get there and it's like, I don't know if this will work out, like, can just let me go do what I was doing.
I don't know if the schedule will work because I did that teaching job for a couple of years and I wasn't a big fan of Monday to Friday, but the advantage with this job is it's about a 30-minute drive away, whereas my previous job was about an hour, so it's less time on the road.
Which also means more time at home. True. And also more money, because you're saving on travel expense.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. But, yes, I think the job description for this role suits me better than...
Then do it, man. Yeah. Life.
Yeah. Robert.
Spend it on regrets. You're holding tears at the end of it.
I don't think I would regret applying or not applying or whether I... do or do not get this job. So, Robert, what do you reckon? Go on.
Considering you spent an entire episode telling us you had no choice in what career you took, you have a choice now. Take it.
Yeah, true. That's very true. Go on, Robert. Chime in.
Less travel equal more taco.
True. No, you're right. Yeah, that was the That was the real bummer about that teaching job I had. It was like 2 hours on the road each day, total, added up. So, yeah, I probably will. I'll let you know. A position hasn't been formally advertised yet, and I'll keep you guys updated. But that's been my week.
Awesome.
As to the Rick and Morty thing, my friend just asks me, how does she know if my text was not a triple bluff? Which, by the way, at the time of recording, it is April Fool's. So there's all kinds of shenanigans going on, including the fact that the episode of Rick and Morty to start season 3 was actually put up on Adult Swim's live stream as a joke. It's the actual episode.
Yep, Dan Harmon double bluffed. It's like April Fool's, it's the real episode.
Yeah, that's amazing. And I thought the Choose Your Own Adventure book for BlizzCon was a great. I wound up contemplating my existence as a dinosaur after spending time at the food trucks. And then they were like, hey, you want to teach pteranodons, this robotic arms, how to read and write? And then they like went into aviation abilities and I got a great job for some reason. Because BlizzCon... Funny. It's so weird. Just roll with it. It's a great April Fool's.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
See, my week has been... See, I don't want to say working. I have to find other things that I've done besides work, because that's not really conversation. It's like, that's expected. It's like being like, oh, I'm alive. It's like, oh, yeah, of course.
True. Go on.
I was going to say, why don't we do this then? We'll jumpstart this conversation this way. Can I go back to Andromeda now?
Oh yeah, that was a thing that happened. The new Mass Effect game came out, and it's either the best thing ever, the worst thing ever, or it's all right.
It's another Mass Effect game. It's actually pretty much what I expected. What I didn't expect, and where I think a lot of people have a very true grievance, and I'm right there with them, why is the user interface such crap? Oh my good lord. It is, like, the worst thing I've ever seen in a video game.
Really?
I have no... Yeah, the user interface is atrocious. I mean, you'll... They organize things pretty well, I'll concede, but there's so much stuff that in order to find out anything you want, you have to go through, like, folders within folders of files of quests and abilities and knowledge and codexes, and trying to track all that is atrocious when they're like, you have 50 quests to do and you can only track one of them, and if the quest is on a different planet than the one that you're on, you can't actually track it until you leave the planet that you're on.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Whoever made the UI has a vendetta against people who play video games.
Yeah. And there's really weird design choices, like say you're on a planet and you get a quest that says check your email, and you're like, all right, how do I check my email? Oh, I have to go back onto my ship. The only way to board your ship is to leave the planet. So you get an email, you leave the planet, you board your ship goes through a cutscene where it leaves the planet, goes into orbit, you check your email, the email says come talk to me again as soon as you can, so then you land back on the planet. To continue, as somebody described it, actually Ricky said, this is like saying I have to go get something from my car, so you get into your car, drive to the other side of town, pick up the item, and then drive back home so that you can just acquire the item that was in your car.
Wow.
It's really bizarre. Now, mind you, I can actually go through the laundry list of things that are wrong with this user interface and the way that the game lets you play it, till Kingdom Come. I'm loving this game. This game is fantastic. It's just that for whatever reason, somebody who is in charge of UI and systems was like, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to try to make this game not fun.
That's sad.
It's very sad, because the game is incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's funny listening to Gallimane complaining about it. He's like, I don't even know. He's like, I got a new gun. It tells me it's an upgrade. I don't know which gun it's an upgrade for. It's like, or if you want to modify a weapon, let's say you have 2 guns, and that's 4 slots for modifications.
Mm-hmm.
You go, okay, I want to modify this weapon. So you click the mod. It shows you the list of modifications. 4 of them have check marks because they're in your guns. It won't tell you which ones. It's just like, yep, these are in use. now which one is the one in the pistol that I'm wanting to remove right now? Crap.
Yeah, like you actually have to remember what you selected. So say you want to replace a scope on your pistol. You choose the scope, and it just dumps you into a list of every single mod you have that can be equipped on the gun, including with little checkboxes next to every single mod that's equipped in all of your guns of that type. So you're like, okay, which of these is the one that I want to use? And then if you don't remember what you're actually modding, because it doesn't remind you that you chose the pistol scope, you have to remember. So if you're sitting there looking at this list for more than a minute and you forget what you're doing, it's like, oh, crap. And then here's the best part. Not only does it make that complicated, but every time you equip one mod, it kicks you out of the mod menu. And you got to re-enter the mod menu. And this is terrible if, like, you don't have two mods. Maybe you've built a custom gun and it can have four mod slots. And you're like me and you're modding your pistol. I can have eight freaking things equipped. And I have no idea what the hell any of them are attached to or which I'm trying to replace. It's insane. Like, who designed this? This is a game based on mountains and mountains and mountains of information, and you may go out of your way to hide this information from me.
Wow.
It's so bad.
It's so bad. Now, like I said, don't take that the wrong way. The game is incredible. I am having the greatest time. I really am. I just, there are things where I'm just baffled. I'm absolutely baffled by the design choice in some cases, like the email, like the UI, all these things. Now, that's not to say that Mass Effect has ever done user interface correctly, because it really hasn't. And that's a whole other conversation as well. I mean, I still have no idea what these bars are. Like, how many shields do I have? How many shields do my squad mates have? I don't know. None of these games have ever actually bothered to tell me this. it's very strange, but this is actually a step backwards in many respects as far as the user interface goes. Now, as far as the gameplay goes, it's fantastic. It's way better. There is one thing though that I will give as far as like the storytelling goes. The game starts very badly, and I don't mean like this is an awful story or anything like that. I mean it starts in medias res in with everything. You create your character, and then the game starts with your character waking up after their 634-year journey in hypersleep. So you have no idea who your character is, you have no idea where you are, what you're doing, why you're there, who the people are around you, who else is waking up, what the situation is. Things then immediately go bad. You don't know what's going bad, you don't know why they're going bad, you don't know who these aliens are that are shooting you, you don't know why they're shooting at you, you don't know anything, and the game expects you to care. And then it spends the next, like, 20 hours making it up to you with a really good gameplay and story, but it starts out like the first 5 to 6 hours are just like, what the hell is going on? You're just so confused, and the game doesn't help you.
Yeah, it's rough.
Yeah, I mean, like, the good comparison that we actually both agreed on was Fallout 4 has the exact same start, right? You go into cryospace, asleep. I mean, Fallout 4 at least gives you a half an hour to an hour, depending on what you want to do with it, sequence before you go to sleep, so that you get your bearings, right? You know who you are, you know who the people are around you, you understand what the stakes are as they change while you're in stasis. And Mass Effect Andromeda really needed 15 to 20 minutes of you meeting the crew, meeting the people, getting to know your fictional dad, you know, getting to understand and establish for yourself who you are and everything like that, and then go to sleep and then wake up and have all these things happen. If they had had like a 20-minute preamble before you wake up, all of those problems do not exist. Instead, it's just like there's a lot of crazy crap going on, and I understand it's a brand new galaxy. I'm not going to understand what's going on immediately. I understood that going into it. But to then, on top of that, say that I don't even know who the hell I am at the same time is really bizarre. And like I said, I can go on like this forever, and at the end of the day, I'll always keep saying the same thing. The game is amazing. It's so good.
Yeah, I'm waiting for it to grab me right now. It really hasn't, like, its hooks aren't in me. I'm like, yeah, this is pretty fun. This is interesting. I like this. But I'm not like, oh my god, I gotta get home from work so I can play this some more.
So how long have you played it, James? So far?
Played it, probably about 30 hours.
And Robert?
96.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay. Okay.
I'm 96 hours in, and my completion percentage says I'm at 54%.
Oh, okay.
Wow. Yeah,
it's a big game.
It's a huge game, and like I said, it spent like the next 20 hours after its beginning making it up to me. Like there's a lot of things that just don't make sense. You meet an alien race for the first time, for example, and immediately they can speak English through their translators, and they don't actually bother to explain until later that you're actually not the first humans that they've met. And even then they do it so roundabout that you have to be paying attention. It's like, it's really weird. And like, I'm having this sequence where I'm meeting these new aliens for the first time, and I'm distracted the entire time going, how do we communicate with each other? How do we understand one another? This makes no freaking sense.
They just said Milky Way. How do they know what the Milky Way
is? Yeah, exactly. I'm like, how do they know that I'm a human from the Milky Way galaxy? And I'm just like in my mind going, well, they have to have met other people. They have to have met these exiles or whatever. You know, I'm just like, I'm really confused. And then later on, yeah, okay, it makes sense. They have dealt with other humans. They have blah, 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 right? It makes sense. It's actually very well written. It's very well done, et cetera, et cetera. But every time they present something to you, they do it in the most confusing and obscure manner imaginable. And things like what I just described there. I'm terribly distracted by this, you know, lack of information. It doesn't lack for sense, right? I mean, it actually is a logical progression of events. But again, I, as the player, am approaching it from a point of absolute lack of knowledge. And then they do absolutely nothing to ease that problem. And it's just bizarre. It's just so bizarre. Once you get past those little things, though, because they are little in the grand scheme of things, once you get past things like that, I mean, the game is very well thought out. The story is actually really intriguing. I'm really enjoying it. There's lots of little callbacks to the original trilogy that I'm really enjoying. And some of them are quite surprising. It's a really good game. I don't want to like go crazy into spoilers or anything for people who want to play it, because I recommend it. It has a narrative mode. So if you suck at video games in general, it has a narrative mode. You can just play the game for the story, which even like what I've just said, the story is good. You just got to give it some time to, get back at it into your good graces. And it does take an insane amount of time to do that after that really awkward start, because it really has a very awkward beginning. And, you know, it took about 40 or so hours for me to actually get to a point where I'm like, yeah, this game's starting to gel for me. And then I got to another planet called Kadara. And when I got to Kadara, the game just came together. Like, I met all the other factions. I understood who was who, what was what, why people were doing what they were doing. It all just suddenly gelled together. I was like, okay, this game's great. But I had to get really deep into it for everything to just start making sense, because your character suffers from showing up late to the party the entire time.
Hmm.
You know, you're in a brand new galaxy. Nothing went right. You know, just to throw it out there, other members of the Andromeda Initiative got there before you. So there are lots of things going on that you're just not privy to, and it doesn't help that the way that they tell the story constantly chooses to not present information to you until after events have occurred. It's like they want you to be confused for dramatic effect, and instead I'm just like, I don't know what's going on, guys.
It's like, why yeah, didn't you just tell me this before? I don't know, I thought you wouldn't like me.
There is a character that actually does that.
Okay.
There is a major, it was actually really good, but there was a major plot point where a character didn't say something very important about themselves because they were afraid about how you would take it. And it was actually really well written, but I was just like, it's just funny to me that you just mentioned that. And I'm like, there's actually a character that does that. And it just made me wonder like how much of the game was written from that point of view. Cause it keeps doing it, you know, like, oh, we'll just throw the character into this situation. They'll be confused. I'm like, yeah, but that's the whole game, guys. But, like I said, once you get through that initial confusion, it makes sense, and then you're like, ah, okay, and it's really, really good. I just can't understand why I keep having to piece the story together backwards. And I kind of wonder, like, if I do a replay, which I'm feeling like I will, because I'm really enjoying it, if I do a replay of the game, will I have these same problems? Because I kind of wonder if they were just too close to it, you know, like, they knew where the plot was going, they knew who the characters were, they knew the setting, and they just kind of forgot to tell you what was going on.
Yeah, like, it's like I described it. it's like people were making these systems and this game and never once stopped and thought someone at some point has to play this as a video game.
Right. Yep.
Yeah, and you know, and like I keep saying, it's really good. it is so good. And BioWare actually just posted at the time of this recording that on Tuesday, April 4th, I believe, they will be releasing an announcement as to things that they're going to do to help improve the experience. One of the things that has gotten a lot of internet attention, which I actually think is just trolling because it's like 0.001% of the game, is the facial animations. Honestly, they haven't been a problem to me, but there's a couple of characters you meet very early on who, yes, do have very bad facial animations.
Yep.
I don't think it's a big deal, but
one of them gave us the meme, "Sorry, my face is tired."
Oh, geez.
Oh, God, no.
Yeah, who wrote that? They need to be shot.
Jesus.
Yeah, they're like yelling at you, and they're like, "Oh, you know, I'm sorry, my face is tired." I'm just like, "What? Is this like some 23rd century colloquialism I don't understand?" What's really great, because you know they've been asleep for 600 years. There are some characters that just they don't know how to comprehend the problem. There was one little conversation I saw where this person's like, "So get this. You're actually 664 years old." He's like, "What?" He's like, "Yeah, because we've been asleep for 634 years. Oh my God, you're right. I never thought of it that way. And check this out. If we don't wake up your big brother soon, he's going to be your little brother."
Uh-huh.
And the dude's like, "What?
What?"
Yeah, it's great. It's great. Like, there's actually a lot going on in the game. It's wonderful. It rewards you for looking around. The more you put into it, the more you get out of it. Yeah. So I mean, I stand by what I've been saying. It is 2017. It is the year of Mass Effect Andromeda. The multiplayer is still badass as shit. You guys should all play it. It's wonderful.
We have all played it together. It was really good.
Yeah. It's. Yeah. I. For as many things that are wrong with it right now, I feel like a lot of them will get fixed, and at the end of the day, we will have a fantastic experience to talk about later. But for now, it's got some rough edges, but nothing but recommendations. So yeah, that was my weekend, 10th week, I'm sure.
So, yeah, half an hour. Why didn't we just make this about Mass Effect?
Because we needed something to do to pad out this episode, because I don't actually have a lot to contribute here. Mm.
And I'll go back a bit, James. You're saying you don't want to. I understand you're not wanting to bring up work each week, but I will take crazy customer stories if you have one a week. That'll be great because I'm sure.
Oh my God!
I'm sure, you come across some crazy customers.
Oh yeah. So what's really cool? I will say this about where I work, since it's a European company, like. European people, like, of descent or through immigration or whatever, all come to my store. People, I was like, "Where have you been all my life? I've never even met a German American," and suddenly I'm just like, "Where have you been?" and it was great. I had a cool interaction with an older lady from the UK. She was like trying to find her money and stuff, and she's like. She's like, "Where did I put that 20? We just got petrol. Where did I know I had some money left over." And I was like, she's like, "I'm sorry, I'm taking up all of your time." I'm like, "You can stay as long as you want. I never get to hear petrol." it's like, you know, we're separated by a common language, but, you know, you take your time. There's so many interesting cultures that I would never, ever, 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 ever encounter in a Walmart. I'm sorry.
True.
But I get to, on a daily basis, interact with so many interesting people. It's super fun.
I'm wearing an Andromeda Initiative hoodie that I bought before Andromeda came out because I'm all in.
He likes Andromeda.
Yeah, I think he does.
So let's get on to this episode. So this episode is going to be about a tokusatsu Japanese show. which is a live-action show that focuses on special effects. It is about a weekly monster that attacks the city. The superhero fights it off. It grows big. They get in a robot and fight it off. It's not Power Rangers. It's 1970s Japanese Spider-Man.
Which is incredible.
So, before I can talk about Power Rangers, I do have to mention this. Because this is a thing. A real thing. Japanese Spider-Man. Somehow, through lots and lots, you know, copious amounts of 70s drugs, Marvel thought it was a good idea to sell the rights of Spider-Man to Japan. And the Japanese looked at it and went, a science nerd who gets bit by a spider turns into a Spider-Man. That's not going to fly over here in Japan. Okay, here's what happens. A daredevil motorcycle rider falls into a cave where a 400-year-old man has been waiting on him from the planet Spider. He gives him the powers of the spider to fight off Professor Monster. That sounds way better.
It does.
I just want to take this time to point out that I don't have much faith in a lot of Japanese storytelling.
So yeah, this show happened, and he transforms into Spider-Man, and he shoots web, and then the monster grows big, and he has a spaceship called the Marveler that turns into a giant mecha robot called Leopardon that has a leopard head on it because reasons. Okay. And he fights them and destroys cardboard buildings a la Godzilla. And this idea of a robot that comes down and transforms and fights and stuff gets taken from the show and put in another television show called Super Sentai, which was a Japanese superhero live-action show that originally did not feature giant fighting robots. And it becomes a match made in heaven. Through some strange... I don't know. I don't even know how or like why anyone had this idea. But the idea came about of bringing it to America. Well, it needed to be edited, you know, changed for American audiences. Because the studio was worried, hey, if we put this in, nobody's going to want to watch a dubbed or a subtitled show of Japanese people in Japan fighting monsters. So what they did... they shot original footage using American actors and actresses, and any time they would transform into their suits to fight the monsters, they would use the footage from the Japanese television show. And that became the Power Rangers. Oh boy. Power Rangers is like...
I'm sorry. I have such great memories of watching this as a kid, and just going, everything seems like of a very different quality.
Yes, it's like you have the Japanese television show with all of its Japanese sentiments, crazy monsters that make no sense. Like there was once a bug with a stoplight on its antenna. I don't know. They got baked into a pizza one episode. I don't understand. But you have that show cut and edited with basically Full House episodes. Just the most saccharine, feel-good, friendship will carry us to victory American 90s TV that you could produce. Like, everyone's a stereotype, everyone's an archetype, Like, it's even so bad that the Black Ranger is black and the Yellow Ranger is Asian. Like, the Black Ranger uses hip-hop Aikido. No. Don't do this. But in spite of such an awkward premise, I watched every episode. I could not get enough of it. And I think that was influenced by the fact that when I was growing up as a child, my grandfather loved Godzilla. He had like all the Godzilla films that would come out. And I watched them constantly. Love Godzilla. Even as an adult, I freaking love Godzilla. As goofy, as campy, as just like Son of Godzilla. Oh God, how did this get made? I love it. I love him being in the big rubber suit, destroying cardboard buildings. It's like 100% me. And I noticed when I was watching this TV show, man, they would call out these Zords that looked like little toys rising out of the ground and flying through the air. They would combine. This looks exactly like Godzilla. Man, I love this. And to the point that even as a child, you know, you would think I would pretend to be a Power Ranger. No. I would go out, I'm like, I'm the Megazord. I'm trashing buildings. I would throw like a stick in the air so that it would fall and stick in the ground. I'm like, yeah, the Megazord. Do this. Like, I was full on into the tokusatsu parts of the show. I didn't even realize it at the time, but I had locked on to the fact that that was the same vein of television as Godzilla. It was awesome. Like, and you're like, well, what's the plot? That doesn't matter. Like, nobody remembers the plot to this show. All you remember is there were monsters, and twice Bryan Cranston voiced the monsters, and that was awesome. So, yeah,
say, as much as I watched it when I was little, I don't remember a damn thing.
Yeah, you can't really.
The strongest memory I have of Power Rangers is when I was younger, I used to write lots and lots of stories just for random things. And one of the things I wrote was a sci-fi bit, and there was a character that I named Kimberly in it. And somebody accused me of stealing the name from the Pink Ranger. And I'm like, Kimberly's a name. Like, that's the strongest memory I have of Power Rangers.
Well, see, here's the thing. The problem with the Power Rangers is they were very static. There were no they were cripplingly static. They had no real character arcs. Billy was the nerdy one. Trini was the Asian one.
Like, that is the extent of her character. She's Asian. Like,
Zach was the black guy. Jason taught a karate class. Kimberly was the Pink Ranger.
Of course she was.
She was just the high school sweetheart. That's all it was.
Yeah.
Like, they are the most stereotypical characters you can imagine, as James said. And I don't think we can actually do service to just how stereotypical they are.
Yeah. It is the campiest, terrible stuff. There are only three characters in the show who ever had story arcs. First two were these characters called Bulk, who was a fat guy, and Skull, who was an anarchist punker. These guys start off as bullies. And it's not a good storyline, but if you pay attention from an objective narrative point of view, they start off as bullies. Then there are situations that arise where something happens, like a baby carriage, you know, a pram goes off with a baby in it, and Bulk, like, you grabs it, you know? Everybody else is, like, being dumb and fooling around, and the bullies of the show, like, show they have some goodness in them. They save a baby. And then, as the show goes on, they become police officers eventually. And then, eventually, one of their greatest character moments is when the Power Rangers have been defeated, Bulk and Skull stand up to the enemies who are going to destroy the Earth, and is like, no, we can't let this happen. Power Rangers or no Power Rangers, we have to fight, even if it means dying. And it's like one of the coolest things ever, because these dudes are throwaway comic characters. And it was like one of those first times where you have a, you know, like a pratfall character that they're like, they get tired of using them as pratfalls, and they're like, let's do something with their story. It was really good. I really enjoy, you know, Bulk and Skull in the later seasons when they're not viciously, sexually harassing the female characters in the show. Because that was a thing that would happen. But the only other character anyone remembers is the character Tommy, played by Jason David Frank, the Green Ranger. My God, the Green Ranger. The best character in the show, by far, hands down, all because in the second season, he's introduced in a 5-episode story arc. It introduces him as a villain. He defeats the Power Rangers. He goes in, he destroys their command center. Then they find out that he's being mind controlled. They go and they defeat Rita Repulsa, who is the antagonist for the first few seasons. Defeat her, find out, oh, he's no longer mind controlled. You can become the Green Ranger. Here's the thing about the Green Ranger. He had a dagger that was a flute. When he would play a tune on it, out of the harbor would come a frickin' Godzilla Zord. It was called the Dragon Zord. Everybody knew it was Godzilla. It was as big as all the other Power Rangers Zords when they were combined. It was the same size by itself. Oh, love the Green Ranger. So good. And Tommy becomes the fan favorite immediately. Because when he's a real martial artist, he brings a certain flair that none of the other Power Rangers do. All the other Power Rangers, they're like, hi-ya, huh, hi-ya. No, Tommy, utsia, huh. Like, really impactful, really character-driven, very characteristic of Tommy. You know when he's fighting. Like, you were a little kid running around on the playground going, utsit-hya, to everybody around. And, the teacher's just like, why is he so violent? It's like, TV! TV violence is the best! And it's super good. And then they decide to make a Power Rangers movie. Why couldn't you just leave well enough alone? Because I watched this movie as a kid, and I was very disappointed. Because in this movie, they get the budget to make all original footage. They get new outfits. Like, they go full in. Like, make an American movie of Power Rangers. They get this horrible villain named Ivan Ooze. Is stupid. When they get to the part of the movie where they summon their Zords, it's all computer animation. The original show was all practical effects. The Zords coming out of the ground were little toy models that would move. Like the T-Rex, the red Zord, was probably one of the best because it rose out of a volcano. And they even had heat effects, like shimmering the air in front of the Zord as it came out and was like roaring and stuff. No, we get full-on computer animation. Like, the worst animation ever. I've seen test animations from the 1980s that were better than what I saw in the theater. They combine, they fight a giant Ivan Ooze in space. They win the battle with the giant bad guy with a robot nutshot. They knee him in the groin, and he flips out into space holding his genitals.
And I miss this.
utter shite. I have never been so disappointed. Like, my child heart was so disappointed. I felt like I needed to sit Power Rangers down and be like, I'm not angry with you, but I'm disappointed, and I need you to understand that you've hurt me. Oh, God, it was so bad. And if you ask anyone, like, who grew up on Power Rangers, like, Power Rangers, right? Did you watch it? Yeah, Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. But here's the problem. The reason Tommy was so beloved was he wasn't used very often. He wasn't used very often because the Sentai footage, which they had to have to show people in costume, didn't have a Green Ranger around. When they do this movie, they end up being able to bring Jason David Frank back as Tommy because there was a new Sentai character who wore white, was the White Ranger, and had a cool Tiger Zord. Well, they asked Jason David Frank to come back. So now he's even cooler. He's got a white and gold outfit. He's got a Tiger Zord. He has a sword with the end of it has a tiger head on it that talks to him. I'm all in. All is forgiven. Whatever. That movie was dumb, but I can live with it. You know, it happens sometimes. And show's still good. They're still doing its thing, still doing big monster fights. And then they get into Power Rangers Turbo. Because after this, Sentai goes, okay, we're not going to use the same Rangers season to season. Each season will be new Rangers with new Zords. And, you know, and so the American version goes, well, we're going to have new actors every season. I hate Power Rangers Turbo. Because it's cars. It's just cars. It's like, oh, I got a truck. Ooh, I got a Jeep. And I'm going, ooh, I'm American. This is boring. Like, cars has been a part of our history forever. Cars aren't interesting. It's just a car. Go back to dinosaur robots that rose out of the eons of old volcanoes. That's amazing. And at this point, I'm getting into, you know, I'm like 13. Starting to be like, I ain't getting this. Like, you got me watching Big Bad Beetleborgs. You know you done something wrong. I'm watching VR Troopers, man. Come on. Like, you've messed up the formula. And here's the thing. That show was horribly troubled. With writing problems, with budget problems, just all kinds of behind the scenes nightmares going on. And you could tell. Like, so the funniest thing about the Rangers originally with the Sentai footage is Trini, a female, would transform into the Yellow Ranger. And she would have the physique of a man. So it's like, what's going on there? Like, you didn't really catch it if you were a little kid, because you didn't know, she doesn't have the anatomy of a female anymore. Didn't you catch that?
I caught it. It confused me.
Like, but with Turbo, they have the Blue Ranger played by an 8-year-old. When he transforms, he becomes a grown man.
Uh-huh.
The voice of a child.
Like, hey guys, let's go get him. Transform Blue Ranger power.
And it's like, giant, ripped martial arts.
Alright, I'm transformed. Let's get him.
It's so bad. It is so bad. Like, this show.
They never reconciled the Japanese show with their casting in the American cuts, essentially. They never bothered, because, as you mentioned before with the Yellow Ranger, the only female ranger in the Japanese version was the Pink Ranger.
Yep. She had a little skirt on her suit.
Yeah, and so was the American one. They were like, well, we're going to have two females instead of just the one. And so they just made the Yellow Ranger Asian, made her a female, and then went with it. And she would transform into a dude. And they just tried to not bring any attention to it. Which was hilarious.
Yeah. And it's so weird. Like, this show is already weird enough without having this stuff go on. And they start running into trouble because there's only so much footage they get from the Sentai. They can only use the parts where they're in their uniform, not showing their face. And when they start doing later seasons, I think it's like season 3 or something, they start making seasons where there's barely any Power Rangers in them. It's just all civilian storytelling with original footage. It's so bad. It gets really, really bad. I watched a little bit of Power Rangers Zeo, which was like the next one. All I know is they brought Tommy back, and then in a little bit of more accidental racism, they cast him as the Red Ranger. He's Native American, so there's that. But, you know, Zeo was pretty cool. And then they had this weird season where there were underwater space aliens who were the Rangers. And they made the Shogun Megazord, which I got for Christmas from my great aunt, one of the best presents ever, because it was the entire Megazord. And since I owned the Falcon Zord that Tommy ends up getting, it would connect with them. And so you'd have this just god-awful, incredible 20-inch tall toy that, like, if I wasn't careful, I could black my eye with the punching action. And then I kind of stopped watching Power Rangers. I just couldn't get in, because after that they went like SPD, which is like Space Police Department or something. And I was like, it's cars again. It's just cars again. Why cars? So I stopped watching because I was like, it's gotten, you know, it started looking less and less like the tokusatsu that I grew to know and love. They started using more and more computer special effects. It got away from the thing that made me fall in love with Godzilla, which was the absurdity of Godzilla is ignored by the fact that it's fun. Like, it's campy. It's not serious. It's incredibly fun because someone took their imagination and said, I'm going to make a thing. I want it to be this giant, scary, radioactive monster. So let's build a giant, you know, really detailed rubber suit, put a man in it, and build little tiny miniature versions of the city to stomp around in. Like, I love that use of imagination. And I felt like it was going farther and farther away as computer graphics improved and started taking over. But in preparing for this episode, I probably should have kept with it a little bit longer until they got to Power Rangers Dino Thunder. Because it's like they saw just how ridiculous it got, and they did a reset. And they bring Jason David Frank in one more time, and he's the mentor. He's the guy teaching the Rangers how to be Rangers. He's an archaeologist. It's supposed to be like Indiana Jones, so they're off going on adventures, finding ancient relics and stuff. And from what I saw, it's really cool. They get back to cool Zords. They're back to dinosaurs that are really cool. You get more Jason David Frank and his Utsitias and all this other cool stuff. And Disney takes over.
goddamn mouse.
And Disney just wants to do syndication and action figures. And there are several times where the show should have been gone. Like, they were, every time, every season, they were like, all right, let's cancel it. Are we going to cancel it? And they never do. So to save on budget, they move the entire show to New Zealand.
Yes, they do.
And so the Power Rangers are made in New Zealand, where Power Rangers are banned.
You gotta explain that one.
It's too violent. So it was banned in New Zealand. So you could probably go off into the New Zealand countryside and watch the Power Rangers in front of you, physically there, making a television show that it was not legal to be shown on TV in New Zealand. Oh boy. And it's funny because for some reason all the actors and actresses try to hide their accents. And so randomly you just have people talking and then they just drop into their accent. Like, well, I say accent, they drop out of their faux Western accent, their American accent,
right, yep,
into their natural speech patterns. And it's just like, why are you guys trying to hide it? It sounds so weird. It's like, oh, hello there. I'm sorry I'm late. Oh, it's okay, I'm late too. No worries. What? What was that? I said, no worries. Oh, man. Disney starts, like, clamping down. It's like, no violence. Like, none. They even tell Jason David Frank, stop using his utsihyas and stuff because they thought it was cursing. They're like, you gotta quit cursing. It's like, what? Yeah, whatever you're doing, those noises, you have to stop those. He's making those noises because you can't see his face in the suit. So he gives context to what he's doing by making a noise when he punches and kicks. They said, stop it, it's too violent. It sounds like cursing.
Oh, Disney.
So the show starts moving towards laser beams. Everybody shoot fires laser beams. Everybody just shoots laser beams. And almost every scene has a giant explosion in the background, even when no one's doing anything. It's just like, oh, like a guy on his motorcycle jumps over a box. The entire backfield explodes in a 400-gallon gasoline fire. It's like, what? He just jumped over a rock. Like, someone does a double backflip. Explosion in the background. What are you doing? It's like, you clearly have no idea what's going on, what the show's about. Like, they're being told they're too violent. They have to shoot laser beams at everybody. Like, ugh. Like,
for the record, Michael Bay is nowhere near this.
No. It is so hard to watch, because as someone who grew up with Power Rangers, Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, watching someone pretend to be Power Rangers is what I felt like. It felt fake. It felt hollow. The campiness was forced. You could tell people were holding back to force things to become more campy.
Yeah, because it's one of the things I think is kind of lost in all of this is you need to remember, you know, this was almost, you know, 20-something years ago when the first Power Rangers came out here in America and, you know, further than that even. But there was an earnestness to it that you couldn't deny. You know, like, it was creating its formula because it was, you know, completely new ground.
Yeah. And I just want to take a step back and tell you the moment I stopped watching Power Rangers. It was when they opened a season with the Power Rangers being forced to fight the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. This was during the time that the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles new mutation television show had just started. A piece of garbage that didn't make it past the first season, thankfully. And in the first, one of the first episodes, the bad guys convince the Ninja Turtles to fight the Power Rangers because they're bad guys. And the Ninja Turtles meet them. So the Power Rangers are no longer in Angel Grove. They're in New York. The Ninja Turtles crawl out of sewer. It's like, whoa, dude. You're like, what? The Power Rangers? But those are like comic book characters, man. In the television show, it was repeatedly broadcast on the news when the Power Rangers were doing stuff. There was specific legislation passed in the show to accommodate the Power Rangers. Like, it was insulting the intelligence of anyone who enjoyed both the Power Rangers and the Ninja Turtles. Because they were acting super stupid. It was... I checked out. I remember seeing it and just turning the TV off and walking away. I'm like, you will not ruin both of my childhood favorite things. Pieces of garbage. Here's the thing. There actually was a guy who worked at Disney who saw the potential that they were missing. So Disney, really good. The girls. Females, young, old. Really good. They got that demographic in the bag. The guy sits here and goes, wait a minute. You got the Power Rangers? And you're wanting to cancel it? Like, every time this comes up, you think about canceling it? You have older teens and young boys that you can get with this. Holy crap, guys, look. So this guy, I can't remember his name, but he had made like 50 shows for Disney. A veteran. He goes, give me the show. I'm going to make a dark, serious television show. I'm going to show you what this is capable of. It's going to be phenomenal. Writes his pitch up, like starts laying down the characters and stuff. He's like, look at this. It's gritty, post-apocalyptic, like kind of like Mad Max. No joke, Mad Max. Like, one of the main characters is in a wasteland in a black charger tearing across the... you know, Australian desert. Like, it is the end of the world. He gets the Sentai footage. It's motherfreaking googly-eyed choo-choo trains. The Zords are googly-eyed choo-choo cartoon trains like Thomas the Tank Engine. The quote that he says, I cannot repeat on this without heavily editing every word he said. He's like, are you mother effing kidding me? I just told Disney I was making a post-apocalyptic and I'm looking at choo-choo train. Does that train have cartoon eyes? This poor man never stood a chance. Disney fires him.
Oh no.
Through no fault of his own. The Sentai was for children this go-round. And he was doing Mad Max. So you could just imagine, like, Mad Max, and then you just cut the Thomas the Train Engine. Thomas the Tank Engine. I feel bad for this guy, because his heart was in it. He acknowledged exactly what Disney was missing out on. And then life... bended reality to screw him over.
It still gets me to this day every time I hear that story.
I can't imagine, like, I don't even understand. No other situation can arise in media. Is there a situation where that happens, where you're writing stuff, but all of your storyline and everything from week to week is decided by another television show in another country that you don't get to see before it's already filmed and sent to you? Man. Oh. I would have watched the bejesus out of some Mad Max Power Rangers. And so, I've been out of it for years now, you know? And they make Power Rangers the movie this year. Saban's Power Rangers. You hear that? Saban. They are letting you know up front they've cut ties with Disney. They're calling it the Power Rangers. And then you look at the trailer. What?
So, no. They just... You said they... So they didn't sell the whole thing to Disney. They just sold the rights to make it. Okay.
Yeah, for a while. Saban takes it back.
Okay. All right.
And is like Saban's Power Rangers. And I'm sitting here and I watch the first trailer and they're like, Billy, Jason, Kimberly, Zach, Trini. And I'm like, oh my God, that's the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. That's the original. They're making this for me.
Yes, they are. I remember seeing that trailer. Like, I haven't seen it, admittedly, but when I saw that trailer, my very first thought was, this looks way better than it deserves to.
Oh, yeah. That trailer looks pretty neat.
And then I'm watching the trailers, and then, you know, I see the CG Zords, and I'm like, oh, I don't know. I don't know. I'm still scarred by what they did with that first movie. And I'm like, do I want to do this again? Do I want to get to the part where they whip out the Zords and they're like terrible, freaking, really bad CG animation? And then I was like, you know what? It's Power Rangers. How often do I get to sit in a theater and watch a Power Rangers movie? Let's give it a chance. My wife and I go. I tell her, you know. I even said this at work. Like, one of my customers was like, oh, it's time for you to go. And I was like, yep, I'm going to watch Power Rangers with my wife. They started laughing hysterically. I was like, no, I'm serious. So we go, and I'm sitting there, and I'm laughing. I'm laughing at the jokes. I'm enjoying the Power Rangers. I'm, like... The Blue Ranger, Billy, completely steals the movie for me. Like one of the first lines. Because, like, they're all troubled. They all meet in detention. So it's kind of like a more serious Power Rangers, if you will. Except it doesn't go, like, full on. It tries to toe that line. Like, they say shit and damn and stuff. And I'm like, ooh, spicy, ooh. Spicy Power Rangers. And I'm watching it, and, you know, Billy, they introduce him. He's sitting there, and he's, like, putting all his pencils in order by color. And a bully takes one and knocks him over and, like, breaks one. And it's like, oh, we're going to have, like, we're going to have, you know, someone on the spectrum. And he literally says that. He's, like, hanging out with Jason. He's like, I just want to let you know I'm not like other people. I'm on the spectrum. And he's like, is that some kind of exercise? No, man. It's like a disorder. Like, I don't behave. Like, no. He's like, man, I'm joking. He's like, well, see, that's the problem. I don't really understand jokes. So I'm not going to be able to laugh at your jokes. I'm like, man, Billy, I love you. You're so cool. Like, any time in the movie he does something, like... Like, something cool happens, he gets excited and claps to himself. And I'm like, oh, Billy. Billy's my Power Ranger. I like him. Because he's so very innocent. Like, the rest of them are troubled. Billy gets put in detention for blowing stuff up by accident. Because he's messing around with chemistry. But yeah, like... And, you know, I watched this movie. It's got, what's that actress? She was in The Hunger Games. She was the crazy... I don't even know what role she... What even that character was in The Hunger Games. The one who wore makeup and powder and just complained about everything.
Effie?
Yes, that was the character. Yeah. Yes, yes. Yeah. I don't know the actress's name.
She's Rita Repulsa.
Okay.
Never have I seen... role so butchered since Jeremy Irons was in the Dungeons and Dragons movie. It's so bad. She does such a terrible job. And I mean, like, it's a campy movie, but even she sticks out like a splinter in your eye. I'm just like, come on now. Nobody directed her. They're like, Rita Repulsa's evil. And she even says the most famous line of Rita Repulsa. Make my monster grow! Like, you know? It's supposed to be like, argh! She go, make my monster grow. And I was like, are you kidding me? She can't even... Was that a one take? Did y'all just break for lunch after that to eat some Krispy Kremes that you advertised throughout the whole movie? Seriously, the most important place in the Angel Grove is the Krispy Kreme. Not from a narrative perspective, it is also the most important place in Angel Grove. The fate of the world depends on the Krispy Kreme. They even have a scene with Rita Repulsa in the Krispy Kreme eating donuts. The only thing she doesn't do is turn and go, buy a half dozen of Power Rangers Krispy Kremes for $7.99. Because Krispy Kreme also has Power Ranger donuts right now.
Of course it does.
They sold that movie to Krispy Kreme, and it's like the essence of all life is in the Krispy Kreme. And I went, yep, yeah. My wife was like, yeah, that's true. Essence of life, Krispy Kreme.
Why not?
And I'm just like, geez. Like, I figured they would be advertising toys to me. No, they're advertising donuts. They know how we roll, us millennials. Like, we're all fat and old, trying to reclaim our nostalgia. Give us a donut. The warmth will remind us of better days. Now, here's the part where you expect me to go, oh, you should go see the Power Rangers movie. This movie was terrible. It was awful, guys. I would not want... Unless you're a Power Rangers fan like me... Unless you think Godzilla is super neat, cool in his rubber outfit, don't go watch this movie. Seriously.
But I want to.
The storyline is garbage. Like, Rita Repulsa literally shows up for reasons. Her corpse is fished out of the ocean for reasons. Like, literally, if a dude wasn't fishing off the coast, this movie wouldn't happen. Like, if a storm would have blown in, he would have stayed home that day, the movie would not have happened. That's bad plot. But, if you do stick with this movie, you get to see some pretty cool swords. I really like the designs. You get to see a really nice 20-minute end fight that's really cool. Also get to see Bryan Cranston as Zordon. They brought him in as a nod to him being in the show originally as the villains. Sometimes. So Bryan Cranston is Zordon, the leader who brings the team together. Like, Billy, in the movie, the character Billy, his last name is Cranston. Like, they were all up on some Bryan Cranston.
Sounds like it.
Everybody loves him. So you get to see that. Okay. This is not an insult to anyone. Because although I may not enjoy the Transformers movie, if you like the Transformers movies, this is a fun movie to go watch. It's completely indulgent. It's like a chocolate brownie with chocolate on top with chocolate mousse and chocolate chips in it. You know, it's completely indulgent. You're not going because you're like, you know, I think we'll be talking about this in 100 years when we've redefined cinema. They'll be like, remember that Power Rangers movie? It's the Citizen Kane of its time. No.
It's not like how Shyamalan tried to push Last Airbender.
I love
his quote where he's like, well, my hope is that we broke so many of the rules that we created new ones. I'm like, no, you just made a crap movie, admit it.
Yes. And Shyamalan, just admit it, you only make movies for yourself. This Power Rangers movie was made for me, no joke, 100% for me. I watched it, I really enjoyed it.
Like, there is even a snippet of the original song when they bring all the Zords out and they're all racing in profile, like all like they're doing that parallax in the background. They're all running to the side of the screen, and it's like, yeah, go, go, Power Rangers. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm sitting up in my seat. What am I doing? Sit back. I don't care about this. I don't think that's the coolest thing ever. Shut up. Quit staring at me, Crystal. Like, I was into it. I was having so much fun. And then, you know, after I'm done, I'm like looking at it. I'm like, this plot was terrible. None of it made sense. All these teens are annoying because they're just like, we can't do it. Can't do it. Why can't we do it? I'm rebelling, but we gotta work together. Well, I'm rebelling against working together. Like, it's so I would slap these people if I met them in real life. I'd be like, slap, shut up. You can turn into superheroes with giant robots. Why are you sad? At that point, what's there to be sad about? The Krispy Kreme got destroyed, maybe. But seriously, it's a bad movie, but it's the best Power Rangers movie I've ever seen. I mean, that doesn't mean very much.
I was about to say.
Me too.
Because the last one I watched had a CG nut shot in space. I will take anything after that.
Okay. I may have to stop trying to drink things
when you make jokes.
Yeah. I think I have to look up that nut shot on YouTube or something. I'm sure it's there somewhere.
Oh, God. Look, when Terminator 2 CG is better than your, you know, late 90s kids flick, you've got problems.
Mm. True. It's funny because, see, when I was watching my, you know, shows on Cartoon Network and etc. I never really caught on to Power Rangers. It was something else other kids were watching. I'd hear the theme song in the background, other kids talking at school, saw all the ads for all the action figures, etc., etc. And I knew it was big, and I knew people were really into it. It just never clicked for me. I don't even know if I've ever seen an episode from beginning to end. It just had no appeal. But
I can save you some time and just say don't do it.
Well, no, that's true. It's true.
If you do, you have to go in at the beginning and understand what it is. Like, just for what it is, the original Mighty Morphin Power Rangers was good for the attempt that they made.
Sure.
That they had no business trying to make, that they were just trying to do as a maybe this will work kind of thing, it's fun.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, hey, No, totally. I mean, I remember having fun with it when I was watching it as a kid. It worked. It actually did work.
Oh, yeah, no, I admit that, yeah, it was huge for a lot of my friends, and it was big on television. And my daughter even went through a phase where she's hooked on it and trying to get me to watch it, and I just keep shirking her off and that. Then the trailer comes on at the movies, and my daughter gets all excited, and she goes, we've got to see it. When are we going to go see it? And I want to see it. I do. It just hasn't worked out. I was really hoping to get to watch it before we recorded this episode, but it hasn't happened. But I do. I really want to go see it. Yeah.
And one of the coolest things about this, leading up to this episode, Twitch gained permission to air 24/7.
Oh, yes.
The entire run of the show, of all versions of the show, starting from the beginning, going all the way to the end, like 500 and something episodes. And I was watching it when I could. And it was hilarious because there were so many people who had never seen Power Rangers. It was their first introduction.
Yeah, I was about to say, the commentary must have been fantastic.
The chat was going nuts! Like, they were rocking out with the song. Everyone loved the original Mighty Morphin Power Rangers song. When the Zord would come out,
Like, they would get the Megazord, and every time the Megazord comes out, typically what happens is it summons its sword, it slices through the enemy falls down, and there's an explosion. And so every time that would happen, the entire chat would go, one shot, Macro, one shot, they're going to get banned, they're going to get banned.
Oh, actually, you know what? You bring that up. That's actually something about Japanese storytelling in general that just baffles my mind. Because I see this in everything. You see it in shows like Razafon and like all of the Sentai shows, because there's a lot more than just Power Rangers now. You know, but you see it all over the place where they have this like procedural where it's like the giant monster appears. They try to use standard weaponry to fight it off. The standard weaponry doesn't work, so they bring in the giant robot, and the giant robot just one-shots the thing into the ground. And you're like, why don't you start with that? It always works. Everything else you try doesn't work. And, like, all the shows do this. They do this. It's like a Japanese obsession.
I think one of the best freaking episodes is the final episode of Season 1. Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, where they fight a creature so powerful they can't beat it, and it dismembers the Megazord. Like, it rips the arms off, and it's like the arms are laying there and the wires are hanging out, and they're just trapped in this depowered Zord. It's really intense, because they usually was just like, monster, swipe, explosion, play that theme song, rock out. And, like, it's so dumb, but it's so fun. It's so very fun. Even as empty as it is, as it's like the empty calories. It is so bad. I love every second of it, because it knows what it is, and it delights in it. I mean, yeah, they go off track when it becomes more formulaic, and then you get, you know, big corporate companies meddling in and affecting kind of the format of the show and whatnot, but I'm very happy that I got to see the new Power Rangers movie. And heck, watching that live stream was great too, watching everyone, you know, having a fresh reaction to something that I watched as a kid and was freaking out, and they're freaking out and they're not a kid. Like, that's how you know something's good. When it's like, it doesn't matter what the age is. Be like, this is fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, it kind of, you know, not to derail the topic, but that kind of reminds me of, like, when Twitch Plays Pokemon happened, and there were so many people who had never played Pokemon experiencing it for the first time through this, you know, Zeitgeist Twitch experiment. And a lot of people were like, wow, this is actually awesome. I understand Pokemon now. And yeah. I can imagine that Power Rangers had the same effect being on Twitch. Because there is a huge generational gap. Like, you don't even think about it. You don't even realize it. I mean, like, one of the things that's been happening to me here lately, I've been hanging around with some rather young people. And it's just amusing to me how it's like, you know what? Yeah, you know, there is that age difference, because we have very different things that we grew up with that we remember being cool.
Well, it's not even just the fact of growing up with different things. Like, I have people who weren't even born when it was relevant, who come through and their children are wearing old Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle t-shirts.
Yes.
And I'm like, everything that's new is old.
Yeah.
You know? Like, they don't understand. Like, I talk to them and, you know, I'm like, oh man, Ninja Turtles. Like, that's really cool. But it was cool for a different reason to me. You've probably never seen the original Turtles.
Well, we are actually living through an interesting time, and I actually think this is honestly to our detriment, but whatever, I'm just going to roll with it, because I only have the one finite amount of time on this planet. But you're going through a technology shift in such a way that you're able to actually generate entertainment in the way that you actually envision it, as opposed to what was capable even 10 years ago, which is why there's constant reboots and resets and all this stuff. Because it's like, it's like, yeah, well, you know, 10 years ago, we couldn't actually make, you know, this character as a movie from this comic book. It would be impossible. But now with our computer animation and blah, 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 and it's getting cheaper and easier, we can totally make that character happen. It's like, I mean, no joke. 20 years ago, the entire idea of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, somebody would have laughed you down into the ground through the sheer stupidity of your decision. You know?
Yeah, see, you also have to know that some of the attempts at making comic book movies, like Reb Brown's Captain America, good God.
Oh, no, I'm aware of that, but that's actually exactly my point. You see, we've been doing these things, and we've been doing them, you know, with such amazing amounts of limitation for so long that we suddenly are free to express visually what it is that we've always wanted to see, and naturally everyone's first reaction is, do the thing that we liked, make it better.
Yeah, because a lot of times it's the people that are fans grew up with it going, well, I have the education and the money, I'm just going to make it like I wanted to see it when I was a kid.
Yeah, and you know,
and we're more narratively aware, so we can be like, "What? We can even make it better. It doesn't have to be some throwaway schlock Saturday morning thing. We can have story arcs and character growth." And
sometimes that's better. Yeah, sometimes it's better. And other times, I feel like the need to, air quotes, modernize actually does a tremendous disservice because they forget that the reason it was good was as a product of its time period.
I will always point. At the best example of the worst example is when they made Lunatics Unleashed after Looney Tunes. Mother of God. Like, that right there, that's how you teach, but this is what you don't do.
Or like the new Ninja Turtles movies.
Yeah.
You know, things like that. There's a point where you just kind of wonder, well, why do you keep trying to do these things, whereas just letting them exist
and move forward
with something new.
Well, here's the thing. It's because instead of coming up with a new idea and hoping it works, you take something that worked in the past, see if you could make a new version that works even better.
I mean, I understand that. I understand why it's happening. I just, to an extent, I just wish they'd leave it alone, because a lot of the people that do that, they forget why it worked in the first place.
And sometimes
it works, and sometimes it really, really doesn't, where they get so lost in fulfilling their own desires or needs, or trying to make sure that they're dark and edgy to fulfill today's Game of Thrones demographic, that, you know, they just completely lose whatever the hell it was they were supposed to be doing in the first place. Ghostbusters.
Oh, no.
I will drag that thing through the mud.
Have you seen it?
No. It's that terrible. It's like when you just hear Caesar, it's like, yeah, they were going to be dance sequences that they decided not to do in the final cut. You're just like, good God.
But they leave the cut where the dance sequence should begin in the movie.
Yes, I've seen it
awkwardly.
I've seen it on YouTube. Yes, I was like, oh my goodness.
Man.
Or like unnecessary sequels such as Independence Day 2, where it's just like, we had 20 years to prepare, so did they, and I'm just like, you had 20 years to write this script.
Yeah.
And then you have the Fast and the Furious, where it's damn the consequences, full speed ahead.
I can respect that though.
Yeah, I mean, at some point I'm gonna have to watch those. Like, because I watched the first one. I liked the first one.
Yeah, I've seen the first one. That's all I've seen, though.
And then I tried to watch Tokyo Drift was awful.
Yep.
But then after that, they lost me. And I'm so, like, why do you persist?
Fast and Furious. You watch the first, and you jump straight to four. And then from four onwards, they don't claim to be works of art, but they are just a great ride.
Wait a minute. So you're jumping in here, you've watched all the Fast and the Furious?
Yeah, I have. I have.
Out of all the random things I would expect you to sit down and watch, it would not be that.
I don't know why. And I don't remember 2 and 3 very well. And I actually don't remember any of them very well. I just watched them for that 2 hours of entertainment. And this, the 8th or 9th one coming out, I'll be there at the cinemas to watch it. It's just what it is. That's it. Whatever it is. I don't care what they call it. As long as they keep the cars, keep either Vin Diesel or Dwayne Johnson in it, I'll go and watch it.
Well, I was at Universal Studios this summer, and they have a Fast and the Furious 3D attraction now as part of the tram tour. And it is the most bizarre thing I've ever seen in my life. At one point, Vin Diesel is jumping from helicopters to helicopters. He's as big as the helicopters are. Like, they're like, no, seriously, they are these tiny helicopters, and he's hanging from them, and he is twice as tall hanging from the railing as the helicopter is.
Like, he's gone full Mighty Joe.
Yeah, it's insane. It's absolutely insane. It's just the most bizarre thing I've ever witnessed. The tram tour is still amazing, though. You should check that out. The new the new King Kong attraction is amazing.
Yeah, it is good. So,
but, yeah, I don't know. I mean, like we're using Power Rangers to segue into all that kind of stuff. But I mean, like, you look at things like the Transformers and other things where, like, they're bringing old stuff back and they're trying to reboot it. And, you know, I'm actually really happy that you had fun with the Power Rangers movie, because there was a part of me that was, like, kind of wanting to go, but I actually suspected that it would be exactly as you described, which is what kept me from going, because I'm just, like, I don't care enough to want to throw down like $20
film. Exactly how I'd put it. Like, unless you're invested in Power Rangers, this movie. Well, see, here's the thing, because I've seen reviews of it. Like, I like to watch Red Letter Media, and they were not Power Rangers fans, and they were like, it's as a movie, it's fine. They were like, it's fine. Like, yeah, it's weird and schlocky, and there's way too much Krispy Kreme advertising money being thrown around, but he was like, it's a fine movie. It's adequate. Like, it's a movie. He wasn't angry or disappointed or thought it was stupid. He was like, it's fine. I like, you know, it's a movie. Yeah.
I think for me, it's seeing the excitement in Samantha wanting to see it makes me want to go and enjoy the movie, watch the movie with her.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I can totally get that. I can actually get behind that even, because I mean, like, there are some things where if they made a movie for it, I would just be like, I don't care what anyone thinks of me. I'm going in.
Yeah.
I mean, like, if they made a live action Pokemon film and it was just from the trailers, the cheesiest, crappiest looking thing you can imagine in your life, I would still go there waving my damn flag and buying the large bucket of popcorn.
I would buy that large super cup that comes with infinite refills. It's just marketing for the movie.
Yeah, exactly. I would throw down. I would just be like, it's Pokemon. I'm all in. And I wouldn't care if it was good or not.
Yeah, that's the way I was with Power Rangers. I was more on the cautious side. I was worried it was going to be dumb. But then I found myself not even trying to pick apart the movie. I was just like, I like it. I'm having a good time, laughing.
Yeah, and that's important.
Yeah,
that's really important. I mean, like, I went through a very similar experience with Jurassic World. Now, bonus, Jurassic World is amazing.
True.
But I mean, I went in there. I was just like, I don't even care. It's Jurassic Park. I've waited way too long for this. Let's do it. And I'm going to enjoy it. Movie was great, right? Like every now and then it just lines up. And, you know, you have, like, this life-reaffirming experience, I guess. It's just like, oh, it was worth it. Oh, thank God. But other times, it's not that. I mean, I got so into Jurassic World, and I watched it the first time, that when the Mosasaur came out and just wrecked the Indominus, I yelled out in the theater, yeah! Because it was just, I was so into it at that point. I mean, literally, the best 2 seconds of cinematic history is when Blue rides on the back of Rexy. Okay? I don't even care. I don't care what led up to that moment. It was amazing. A Velociraptor and a T-Rex double team some bastardized weapon thing. And it was the greatest thing I've seen in my life.
Yeah.
You know? And like I said, and like for bonus points, it was actually a good movie.
I do have to say, the one thing that I was like, oh, guys, why did you do this? At the end of the movie, there's an after credit scene.
Oh, no.
Oh, really?
It's like, go on. Yeah, it's not spoiler, because I don't even know if another movie will... I don't know if it's going to make enough money for another movie to be made, but it's like, They're sitting there, it's detention again, and the teacher's calling roll for detention. It's like, all right, we got a newcomer to the class. Tommy Oliver. And then it shows a chair with a green jacket draped over the back. Right. I'm like, don't do this to me.
Yeah.
Don't you do this to me. Like, Dragon Zord is life.
I wouldn't be surprised if it's made some decent money, honestly.
It also has a cameo by Jason David Frank, and I can't remember anyone that's not Tommy and Kimberly. I almost remembered her name. But yeah, it's got cameo by them at the end of the movie. It's really nice. I was like, yeah, I love you guys.
According to Box Office Mojo, Power Rangers has a budget of $100 million, and as of now, it has been out for a week, and it's made $73 million. That's decent chances.
That's U.S. only, right?
Yeah, that's U.S. only.
Okay. No, U.S. only is $54
million. Oh, okay.
Foreign is almost $19
million. Yeah, so it's not doing too great.
Hmm.
Man, well, did you see...
Apparently, Ghost in the Shell opened up this weekend, and it's on track to only make $20 million this weekend. That's not good.
No.
Ghost in the Shell. Here's the thing about Ghost in the Shell. I know what Ghost in the Shell is because I was an anime nerd when I was a young teenager. Ghost in the Shell is super niche.
No, it is, and I'll tell you right now, that movie has to be good, because if it's not, my brother's on suicide watch. I'm going to lose a Fury Warrior.
Oh, God. Just let him watch the original movie. Just let him watch the
original movie. No, he has all of it. He has all of it. My brother has all of it. Major is his desktop wallpaper, okay? Every time he turns on his phone, you see Major. So Ghost in the Shell has to be good for his sake. Ooh. Yeah, we haven't gone to see it yet because he's away right now visiting friends. But yeah, I'm really hoping it's good.
Yeah, I do too. I mean... Here's the thing. We've reached a point where Hollywood's willing to take the risk to make a Ghost in the Shell movie. What is going on?
I also don't know if they will be rewarded for that risk. That's the problem, though. I mean, you see some things get made. They're willing to take that leap, and then it's not rewarded. You know, I mean, I'm still kind of reeling at what happened with Warcraft, which I think is a much better film than a lot of people made it out to be. But, I mean, how does something that huge only make $50 million in America? That's insane.
Yeah. True.
It's not even that bad. I mean, yeah, it could be confusing. I don't know. I don't understand people. I think there's too much... I don't know. Hey, that gets into a topic that we're about to like go off in the weeds, off in the jungle.
Yeah.
But I don't know, man. I just think it's weird. I live in an age where I've been able to see a Godzilla movie in theaters, a Power Rangers movie in theaters. There's a Ghost in the Shell movie coming out. Like, Netflix is doing a Death Note live action.
What in the hell? I know. I'm just...
I just don't know. One Punch saved anime. And there's a Rick and Morty episode that I've got to go watch.
I know!
Alright.
As soon as they're done here, I got to check that out and then go back to Andromeda.
And I love Power Rangers.
No, it's not bad. It's just, it's one of those things where, unfortunately, you know, I've outgrown it in such a way that I can't really see myself going back to it. But that doesn't mean I think it's bad.
Yeah, I'm never going to sit down and watch any of that stuff again.
Yeah, for sure. I don't know. It's one of those things, too, where, like, the premise... I don't actually think there is a way that you can make, like, an air quotes mature version of it. It's just not meant for that. You know, it'd be like somebody making the mature My Little Pony. Like, what is that supposed to be?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
By the way, friendship is magic.
Oh, God. Stay tuned for our next episode where we all reveal we're bronies.
I've only seen like one episode, but it was pretty good.
I think that's our episode. I think we can stop at My Little Ponies right now.
Yeah, I think
My Little Pony.
Look, I, as a person who sat and watched SpongeBob to understand the cultural mimetic history, I'm afraid to watch My Little Pony. I may be like, here's my dissertation on its merit.
I totally get you too, man. Like I said, my friends have they've all watched SpongeBob, and I can tell that it, like, you're different. You're different because of this show.
Like, and I'll do stuff like that. I'll go off on these, like, data gathering ventures, and then I'll have to go to the mirror and look at myself, and look at myself looking back at myself, knowing what I am inside. It's like, you're weird. You know that, right?
Well, it's like Rick and Morty. I never recovered from Rick and Morty, and then I was introduced right afterwards to Invader Zim, and I'm like, I'm doomed.
Yeah, exactly.
Because, like, now I understand. Now I get it. You know, I have seen Dark Harvest, okay? I watched a guy burp out an intestine and slurp it back up. I understand now. I get it.
Yeah, it's why I'm sticking with Adventure Time. I haven't even touched Steven Universe yet. I can't handle all the awesome stuff that's out there. Okay, this is our episode. Power Rangers is cool. Unless you're grown, then it's probably not cool. Unless you're a weirdo like I am, and then it's always cool. You can give us feedback on Facebook, facebook.com/n1scan. We release our episodes whenever I can be browbeaten into finding time to edit them. Which Veet may be helping with that. I love you, Veet.
That's okay. You're welcome.
But yeah, what's the next episode going to be about?
All right, here we go. I should have practiced this, but here goes. 50 years has passed, but I do not age. Time has lost its effect on me, yet the suffering continues. Aku's grasp chokes the past, present, and future. Hope is lost. Got to get back to the past, Samurai Jack. So, after 13 years... they're bringing back a fifth and final season of Samurai Jack, and it's one of my most favoured animated series, modern animated series. And we're three episodes in, loving it all. I don't actually have a truly legal way of watching it in New Zealand, other than what people throw up on YouTube, but this fifth season has just been brilliant, and it's all the old memories have flooded back, and my daughter and I are sitting side by side watching it. So next episode, Samurai Jack.
Oh my god, I get to talk about Samurai Jack and minimalism. Yes!
Yes.
I'm so excited.
Alright, can we go back to Andromeda now?
Yep, let's do that.
I'm gonna go eat cheese sticks.
Okay, I got another galaxy to go save.
Bye.
Bye-bye.